I was thinking about the freedoms that we fight for, that there's another war at stake right now. There's many wars going on, but there's one war that we really should be concerned about. And this morning message, I want to talk about a soldier in training. A soldier in training. I believe that God is preparing us to be people who are engaged in a warfare that is not of this world. A warfare that is against powers and principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places. I believe that God is preparing us to be a people that are discerning in the age in which we live and who are able to pay attention to what's going on and not just bypass it and blow by it and disregard what's going on, but really gather in the information, begin to come out with an outcome in our mind as to the reality of something's going on and it's beyond the realm of the natural. Freedoms that are being fought for in the natural, they're also being fought for in the spiritual. There's a spiritual battle going on. And as much as we need to see things change in the natural within our world, we really need a change in the spiritual understanding of what's going on. There's an ignorance that has clouded the mind of a generation to disregard what's going on. And anyone who's ever been in battle knows that in times of warfare, you do not engage yourself in civilian practice. It's there that you find yourself and get yourself into a whole lot of trouble. And so I'm just going to lay out for you three basic points this morning. And I'm going to start it, if we could read and turn in your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 22. You know, this has all been sparked and stirred up in my mind because of a study I've been doing on the mighty men of David. And I've been sharing that Monday night with the men in Bible study in my living room. And Wednesday night, we've been talking about it a little bit in the small group of people that have been here. And it's really just been kind of taken over my thought process as to how deep this goes and what God is revealing in terms of what we are called to do. Amen? You know, we can't give up yet. We can't give up yet. And to go back to those who have fought for this nation, many say, America's under judgment, under severe judgment, and we see the sin that's come take place within our nation, But I want to also bring to light another perspective that America has been the greatest nation in terms of sending missionaries all over the world. That we've had more impact on the world as a nation than any other because of the amount of missionaries that have gone out and continue to send out missionaries all over this world. And we continue as an assembly to send out missionaries and to support in different ways. And we'll continue to do that by God's grace because we believe in the world hearing about the message of Jesus Christ. A little over 2 years ago, I was going to visit my brother down in Dallas, and was flying from Providence to Chicago. Don't ever fly into Chicago, because every time you go there, there's some kind of storm or something going on. And so I was in a layover delay, and I started to get a little bit frustrated. And those of you who travel understand that feeling. And I'm starting to get like, oh, I should have just drove to Boston and taken the flight that my brother suggested where there's no layover. And I started to go down that road for a second. And then I said, you know what, Lord? You must have something here, an opportunity. And so I started to change my attitude and my perspective. And I started to just pray, Lord, who can I engage with here in conversation? And I look over and there's an Indian man, Indian from India. And he's sitting there and he's got a book open about this size and looking just like this. And I go over to him. I said, what are you reading? He said, oh, I'm reading the Word of God, the Bible. It was all in Hindi. So I said, oh, yeah. And I went over to my backpack, and I unzipped my backpack, and I pulled mine out. I said, I got one too. Led to a conversation. We started talking for the next hour and a half as our flight was delayed. We had a great conversation. He gave me his card, and he, Pastor Abraham Varghese, Rehoboth Full Gospel Assembly, and he ministers in Mumbai, where Pastor Rashesh is from. And we started talking, and he says something to me that will always stick with me. He said, you know what I believe? I believe that America will never, that America will always be blessed by God. He said, I believe that the favor of God is on the nation of the United States, and I believe that America will always be under the favor of God because of what she has done for my country in bringing the gospel to us. The transformation that's taken place in my life and those that I know because of the gospel that's come to us because of America. It was a kind of a different perspective of understanding what we were called. We were called to be a lighthouse to the world, weren't we? We were called to be those who bring change, instruments of good change, positive change. And the greatest change that could take place in any life is to hear the good news of Jesus Christ, that God reconciles sinners. Amen? But we're in a battle against that. Everything in our world fights against the light. So I just want to remember this Sunday morning that we're soldiers in training. How many people can accept that call? How many people could say, you know what, I embrace that challenge? Because those who know what it means to be a soldier, and I thank Shane back there for his service, knows that the first introduction to the military isn't necessarily a pleasant one in boot camp, is it? You know, those who were members of the Marine Corps know that that is called Hell Week. And there's a reason for that. I've talked of others who've served in different military divisions, and some would say go in the Navy or the Air Force, or a little easier boot camp than the Marines or the Army. And I might get in trouble for saying that, but I'm just repeating what I've heard. I myself did not serve in the military, but I thank God for those who have. I don't take it for granted. But I know this, that God's called me into a different army. It's the army of God's army. It's the Lord's army. And he's called me into that to be one who engages in it fully. And I realize this, that there's times where I'm involved in boot camp. And what I'm learning in boot camp is this, that my life is not all about me, because my misstep could be another's disaster. Isn't that the truth? That if I don't fully embrace the mentality that my life is no longer my own to do as I wish, because I'm now in combat, then I could cause another's demise. And it's important that we understand that God has called us to engage fully in the surrender of our lives for a cause greater than ourselves. Amen? And as we look at David's mighty men, we see that they came to him just like many of these punk kids come out into the military, thinking they're going to take the world by storm, or coming with just a straight out bad attitude and were kind of forced into the military because they had no other option. Isn't that true, Shane? And we read in 1 Samuel chapter 22, now David came to Nob. I'm sorry. Chapter 22, I was reading chapter 21. And David therefore departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And so when his brothers and all his father's house heard it, they went down there to meet him. And everyone who was in distress, and everyone who was in debt, and everyone who was discontented, they gathered to him. So he became a captain over them. And there were about 400 men with him. And then David went from there to Mizpah of Moab, and he said to the king of Moab, "Please let my father and my mother come here with you till I know what God will do for me." So he brought them before the king of Moab, and they dwelt with him all the time that David was in the stronghold. Now the prophet Gad said to David, "Do not stay in the stronghold. Depart and go to the land of Judah." So David departed and went into the forest of Hereth. And I read that this morning to understand that the beginning might not be very pretty, but God has a way of working a beautiful story out of a very raw beginning. God has a way of painting a beautiful picture from what appears to be broken pieces. Many come to God at times of brokenness. It's led the secularist and the humanist to say that religion is nothing more than a crutch for the weak. Not understanding is the fact that our hearts are so resistant to God until we have some type of breaking in our lives. We're so independent, so in need of a boot camp. We come thinking that we're going to take the world by storm and not realizing that we need to get the world knocked right out of us before we have a right perspective on things. And that's why the breaking's necessary in our lives, because we don't willingly see clearly. We see through this lens that's so faulty, so foggy and made up of our own worldview and opinions. And it's amazing how everybody in the world's right, isn't it? And God has a way of bringing us to a place of distress and discontent and debt to understand, I need change. I need hope. I need a future. I need to do something with my life because it's not working out quite the way I had planned. If you turn with me one more verse, you keep your finger there for a moment too. Matthew chapter 11. I'm reading from verse 25. I know these are familiar passages. I read that a couple of weeks ago, the story of David's men coming to him. But I believe it deserves repeating. And here in Matthew chapter 11, reading from verse 25, at that time Jesus answered and said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you've hidden these things from the wise and the prudent, and you've revealed them to babes. You've hidden these things from the wise and the prudent, and you revealed them to those who have no understanding, to babies. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight. All things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. Nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. And then Jesus says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and lowly in heart, and you'll find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I'm going to show you this morning that three essential qualities are calls to being a soldier, and the first is this, that you need to know that you're welcomed. That there's an open door. You need to know that there's an opportunity and it's calling you. You need to know that when you come, you're not going to be turned away. That God's going to receive you just as you are. He's not expecting us to be making the change. He's the one who's going to make the change. He's going to reveal to us things that we did not previously know. Things that have burdened us, things that have brought about the distress and the debt and the discontent, things that have brought about the heaviness and the labor and the burden and the toil and the sweat of the brow and the seemingly like locked into a position that I can't ever make any forward progress. I keep finding myself stuck. He invites us to come. We're welcome. We're welcome. Let me tell you this, there's never been a greater warrior that's ever lived on this planet than Jesus Christ. These paintings that have been developed by the Roman Catholic Church and others of this flowing blonde hair and this white, very feminine countenance, I don't believe it holds any weight in the light of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that the Bible teaches about. You know, I was noticing Marianne works for a gentleman who owns Allie's tax shop over down the street, and last Saturday he came over and helped with the front garden, Steve. And he said, I think we need some type of rock here to add to the landscape. And I'm like, yeah, it sounds like a great idea. Little did I know he's going to show up with a boulder. I thought it was a great thing. And I noticed as he's picking this thing up, he's a man who you could see by his hands. His hands were very evident that he was a worker. His hands just told a story. You could see he's just, for the size of the man that he was, he had large hands that were well-worn and skin like leather, like, you could tell these were working hands. I believe Jesus had working hands. I believe it was evident that Jesus didn't have to worry about going for a manicure and a pedicure. And I'm sorry, guys, I'm not giving you a hard time if you do. I'm just saying Jesus wasn't of that type, as I see it. He was a man who was either a stonemason or a carpenter by trade, and he had broken skin on his fingers and hands that were well worn and hands that knew how to work and hands that knew how to war and knees that were well worn because he knew how to pray and he knew how to war in heavenly places. He was one who knew how to take care of his brother and make sure that they didn't fall in the line of battle. We read this morning in John chapter 17 in Sunday school that Jesus said to the Father, Father, of all that you gave me, I lost none of them. But the only one was the son of perdition, which was in the scripture recorded of. Jesus was a man who knew how to fight for his friends. And he was who knew how to win victories through strategic moves that the enemy didn't understand. He was militarily advanced in ways that we don't know. But as we get to know him, we've realized this, that God knows the way to victory. And he knows the path to perfection. And he's offering it to us, the guidelines, to know how to win the wars that are presented before us. Don't you thank God that we're welcomed with him? See, when the men came to David, David didn't turn them away. They were in distress. They were in debt. They were discontented. They weren't coming all act together, just as the military invites these young men to come. But in the invitation to come as they were, it wasn't not, you're going to stay the way you are. No, there was going to be transformation and change, because we want to make you into something that you would never see of yourself. We're going to build you into something that you would never be built into if you were not put to the pressures that we're going to put you to. Because we know when pressed, bad attitudes will come out if there's not transformational change taking place. God brings about transformational change through his son, Jesus Christ. We don't have to stay the way we were. We don't have to live in old patterns and old mindsets and old behavior and old addictions. We don't have to stay there. God offers us hope. Don't you thank God for that? He welcomes us in. We don't have to stay there. See, David didn't turn these men away. He embraced them in the state that they were in. They weren't necessarily bringing anything to the table in their current state. They were in distress. They had bad attitudes. They were in debt. They had no financial means of providing for this. And they were discontented. They were bitter of soul. Just a turn, and all of a sudden, the attitudes returned and had to deal with the bad behavior, because bad attitudes lead to bad behavior, don't they? But David didn't turn them away. David invited them in. He welcomed them. Don't you thank God that we're welcomed in? See, it was a picture of what Christ does with us. He said, "Come to me, all you who labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest." He didn't say, "We're not going to do nothing." He said, "No, we're going to work. But we're not going to do the work you're accustomed to working. We're going to work in a new way. I'm going to show you how to work, a work that actually has effect. I'm going to start to teach you the way to actually have progress. I'm going to teach you the way to break the things and the patterns that you haven't been able to break in the past. I'm going to teach you how to work and not be worn out. I'm going to teach you how to war and not be defeated. I'm going to teach you how to do things God's way. And so I want you to take up a yoke next to me. I want to take up a position next to me. And I want you to learn to find rest for your souls in the midst of making progress." We're welcomed in. Isn't that good news? We're going to learn a new way of doing things. See, repentance is necessary for progress, because repentance is a change in the way we think. Let's just get it out there from the get-go. We think terribly. We think wrongly. We think wrong thoughts and make rash judgments. Amen? Can we acknowledge that? We think, and we have a way that's set for ourselves that we think is right, but the Bible says the end of that way is death. Let's just make that clear from the get-go. The human mind, the natural mind, is warring against God. We don't receive the things of God. We're thinking God wants to take something away from me, and I don't want to give it up. We're thinking wrong. We're thinking God's out to get me because of the things that I've done in the past. We're thinking wrong. We're not thinking in accordance with what God reveals about himself. We're thinking about our perspective of what we think God is like. Wrong thoughts. We need repentance. Amen? But we're welcomed. We're welcomed. Don't you thank God we're welcomed? I'm going to look at a lot of scriptures here today. Is that okay? I'm not going to take long. Could we turn over to Psalm 110? Psalm 110. For sake of time, I'm not going to read the whole psalm, as short as it is, but I would encourage you to read Psalm 110. It's a psalm of David, and it's a psalm that's speaking prophetically of Jesus Christ. And he says, "The Lord said to my Lord," verse 1, "sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool." It's a pretty good way to start things, isn't it? When the Lord says to the Lord, "Listen, I'm going to make all your enemies your footstool." Sounds like a good way to victory, isn't it? When God says, "I'm going to fight your battles for you, and I'm going to make all the ones who oppose you sit underneath your feet," that's a sure sign of victory. And Jesus is saying, "Come on, yoke together with me. I'll show you how to win." Amen? Stop fighting against. Stop resisting. See, the horse and the mule, they need a bit and bridle put in their mouth because they have no understanding. But us, we have been spiritually awakened to understand what it is that God is speaking to us. Less and less do we need a bit and bridle in order to move us. We should learn how to be directed by the command of God, by his voice. Amen? See, a war horse that's truly been trained in, at different times in history, horses were necessary, cavalry. They were a strong part of the military force. And no one wanted to take an untrained horse out to battle, lest it cost you your life because of a stubborn horse. The better a trained horse, the easier it was to hear just a command, just small commands, small movements were enough to make that animal obey the master's command. Amen? So I read verse 3, and it says, your people shall be volunteers in the day of your power. And the beauties of holiness from the womb of the morning, you have the dew of your youth. As we read through the psalm, it's a prophetic psalm concerning Jesus Christ. And here in verse 3, it says, in the day of his power, his people would be what? They would be volunteers. They would be volunteers. There was going to be no draft. It was going to be a volunteer army. It was going to be an army that you were invited to, that you were welcomed into, but you had to make the choice. You had to make the choice. They were volunteers in the day of the Lord's power. Some people would like to be a volunteer in the Lord's army today. He talks about the coming forth and the beauty of holiness from the womb of the morning, having the dew of your youth. And they say in the Hebrew, that's a very difficult passage to understand. The Hebrew is really difficult to understand in this passage. And some would say that there was this gathering together that Jesus is surrounding himself with youthful individuals, that he had the dew of the mountains, just in number, that God was building for himself an army. God was building for himself an army who would be volunteers in the day of his power. I've told you before about David, as he had invited his men, and he just had open doors. Open doors were enough. Let me tell you something. The best things don't need to be advertised. Word of mouth goes a long way when the product's good. And I'm telling you this, that when you begin to understand who you are in Jesus Christ, you're going to want to recruit some volunteers to be involved in this sure victory, which is found in Jesus Christ. The warrior of all warriors, the king of all kings, and the lord of all lords. Don't you want somebody involved in this army? That they wouldn't be found on the defeated side, but they'd be found on the winning side. We know we win, and the end of the book says we win. Praise God. We win. No matter what the weapon is, I want you to know, we win. We win. Doesn't matter what the weapon is. Doesn't matter what's been fashioned against you. We win. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Every tongue that rises up against you in opposition will be silenced. This is the heritage of those who are the servants of the Lord. It's our heritage. We read the last verse of this psalm. He shall drink by the brook of the wayside, and therefore shall he lift up the head. Here's the cool thing I want to see is we're welcomed because he's familiar with where we're at. He's going to drink by the brook of the wayside along the way. Amen? He's going to drink. The word literally means the way is, or course of life. And in the course of this life, he's going to drink by the waters of this course of life. He knows the path that we're on. He understands his men that are coming to him, distressed and debt and discontented. This is David who's on run for his life. David who's hiding in a cave of Adullam, one who had received for himself the sword of Goliath from the priest. Remember? And he's thinking he is living in such a stronghold that there's only one entry point, and the entry point is so secure that he believes for himself that one sword is enough to protect himself against the enemy engagement. He's protected in this stronghold, and in this, the men come out to him, and he understands their feelings. He understands that they're walking through. He understands their road. He understands the hopes and the aspirations and the dreams that these men once had that are now crushed. These men are coming to him crushed in spirit, crushed, bitter in soul. Why? Because they had in their minds a plan for their life, what it would look like, and now they find themselves here. And they come out to David. And why did David welcome them? Because he was familiar with their weaknesses. Sounds like Jesus. We have a high priest who's able to sympathize with our weaknesses. For he was tempted in every way just as we are, and yet he was without sin. See, we're not dealing with one who doesn't understand. We're dealing with one who understands completely. And therefore, we're welcomed. Isn't that good news? See, Jesus welcomes us knowing right where we are. We don't have to hide anything to Jesus. We don't have to hide our distress. We don't have to hide our debt. We don't have to hide our discontentment. We can come just as we are. Jesus isn't going to turn us away because of that. So many people believe they need to get their act together before God will receive them. They don't understand grace. God's saying, come to me just as you are. But here's the encouraging word. You will not stay there by God's grace. He's preparing you for the very things that you could not attain. He's preparing you for the very things that have caused you to be bitter of soul because you had thought, but God had planned. You had destined, but God had preordained. God has called you. Thank God for his grace. Amen this morning. Point one, God welcomes us. He welcomes us. We're welcomed. The second point we have to remember is this, that we're strangers and we're pilgrims, wandering in a land that is not our home. See, when David received these men, where were they? They were in a nation not their own. Think about it. They're in Moab. A nation that had not done well, had not a good history with Israel. And it's here that David has men come out to him, and here he goes to the king and says, listen, king, I need a place for my mom and my dad. Can you provide it for them, please? They're not safe even. You know you're in a bad situation when you need to worry about your mom and your dad. And David's concerned. And he comes to a king knowing this. The promise is before us, but listen, people, this world's not our home. We're strangers and pilgrims in this world. Amen? We're strangers and we're pilgrims in this world. Let me read from Hebrews chapter 11. Point two, we are strangers and pilgrims in this world. We're welcomed, but we're strangers and pilgrims in this world. Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 13. Hebrews 11, verse 13. 13 through 16. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off. And were persuaded of them and embraced them and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from which they had come out of, they might have had an opportunity to have returned. A couple weeks ago, we talked about that. The men were able to return back when they came to Ziklag, and very easily they could revert back to the country that they had come out of, to those feelings of distress and discontentment and bitter of soul that they are again in that place, not understanding that God was moving them past their past. And he was moving them into their present, which was filled with God's future hope. See, they were strangers and pilgrims in the world. It talks in Hebrews chapter 11 of all these men and women of faith that had seen promises afar off. And though the promise seemed so far off, they were able to take those promises afar off and say, listen, those promises are going to move me towards that direction, and I'm not going to embrace all the principles of this current age. Verse 16 says this, but now they desire a better country, that is a heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared them for a city. He hath prepared them for a city. See, David's men and David himself are out in a land that's not their own. You got to remember that David had already been anointed by the prophet of God as the king of this nation, and now he's in a homeland that's not his. It's a picture, isn't it? See, Jesus was the king of Israel, and his own people he came to rejected him. But as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the children of God, to as many as believed upon his name. See, Jesus was revealing to us this fact of, even though you're in this world, you don't have to be of it. You can pass through this looking to a better homeland, a heavenly city, the New Jerusalem. Amen? And that can motivate you to live a life of progress, a life that is beneficial, a life that is blessed. Amen? We jump down to verse 34 of the same Hebrews chapter 11. It says this, giving testimony of all the things that happened because they considered God faithful and they considered to forsake this world for a better home. It says they quenched the violence of fire. They escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weakness, they were made strong. They waxed valiant in fight. They turned to flight the armies of the aliens, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains, in dens and in caves of the earth. It's talking about David and his men. And all these having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. Faith pleases God. Faith keeps us aliens and strangers in this world. Hope keeps us alive, knowing that God has prepared for us something greater, that the anointing has been placed upon our lives, that we've been anointed as kings and priests. We have a promise on our lives, and therefore we don't have to be discouraged by the circumstances, though they might be adverse, though we might find ourselves dwelling in a land that's not our own home. God says you can make the best of the situation, and even there you can prosper and be blessed. Can I get an amen this morning? Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2, 3, and 4, "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that wars entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he might please the one who has chosen him to be a soldier." See, we're strangers and we're pilgrims in this world. We're just passing through. And in the midst of warfare, we don't get engaged in civilian activity. It's civilian activity that actually takes us down. What a poor testimony it is to be a man who's called with a purpose and to surrender that purpose for pleasure and to find your life taken from you because of pleasure. Pleasure is deceitful, and pleasure will become a snare and a trap that will ultimately kill us. We will forget our home and we'll embrace the world as if it is our home. We'll start to build houses rather than living in tents. We'll start to think that this is it, and we'll forget that heaven is our home. We'll begin to think heaven's far off, and we'll begin to think less thoughts about heaven and more thoughts about this life, till heaven becomes an afterthought and this life becomes everything. And we've lost the very call that's on our life to be soldiers in God's army. No man that wars and tangles himself with the affairs of this life. In 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 1, it says, "It came to pass after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried and still at Jerusalem." 2 Samuel 11, 1 says, "At the time where kings are supposed to go out to battle, David took his head of military advancement, his major commander, Joab, and he said, 'I want you to get together some men, and I want you to go out in my place. I'm going to stay here in Jerusalem.' At the time where kings are to go out to war, David stayed home and engaged in civilian activity. It's only a few verses later we see David waking up in the middle of the night, going out onto his roof and seeing a woman bathing. And next thing you know, he's asking that that woman would be taken to his home. He's sleeping with her, having an adulterous affair with this woman and making her pregnant in the process. It's Bathsheba. When you engage in civilian activity, you forfeit your own mercy. And you make decisions based upon your current pleasure and lust because you've lost sight of the big picture. It was at this time that David's life will begin to crumble into pieces. It will be at this time that David's greatest mishaps will take place. Listen, David's supposed to be at war, but he's engaged in civilian activity. And he's making the worst decision of his life. We know the story that he'll go on to have the husband of this woman taken off the battlefield. He himself is a warrior of warriors. His name is what? Uriah the Hittite. He's listed in David's mighty men. He's listed in David's mighty men. He's listed in David's mighty men. Faithful to David. Faithful warrior. Man that was engaging in many people at a time, and they were no match for this man, for he was a warrior of warriors. And David has him taken off the field and commissioned, "Go home and be with your wife." And he says, "I can't go out and be with my wife and lay with my wife when my men are on the battlefield." He was a man of integrity. He slept at the gate of the castle or the David's home. He wouldn't even go home. He slept outside. "I'm not going to enjoy civilian activity when my men are in war." David's looking for plan B. How do I get this man to sleep with his wife so that I can patch up my mess? He won't do it. He's too much of a man of integrity. So David has no other choice but to have his men put Uriah the Hittite, a man of integrity, a man of warfare, a man of faithfulness, on the front lines in the heat of the battle, and then ask that they would withdraw the forces so that this man would be put to death. Not only when you engage in civilian activity do you begin to think immoral thoughts, you begin to make very rash decisions, and you begin to surrender even your own victories. Uriah was put to death because David wasn't where he was supposed to on his post. See what happens when we start to engage the principles of the world? It becomes this domino effect that destroys our life. We're strangers and we're pilgrims. Amen this morning? It's interesting because the second biggest mistake that David makes is he takes a census. And in 1 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 1 and 2, it says the same words, "And it came to pass that after the year was expired, at the time the kings go out to battle, that Joab led forth the power of the army and wasted the country of the children of Ammon, and came and besieged Rabbah, but David tarried at Jerusalem. And Joab smote Rabbah and destroyed it, and David took the crown of their king from off his head and found it to weigh a talent of gold, and there were precious stones in it, and it was set upon David's head, and he brought also exceedingly much spoil out of the city." Here is that he's supposed to be at war again, and here he is, same testimony. He's sending out his man to do it. Whether it's the same account or not, it appears that it is, but there's two accounts mixed together because there's two different battles that go on with Ammon, and here it is again, and the very next chapter starts that Satan stood up against David and caused him to number all of Israel. The second biggest mistake he makes is right there in the same scheme of him engaging in the activity that God said, you're supposed to be on the war front. And here you are in your temple. Here you are in your home. Here you are in luxury and pleasure. Why don't you get an understanding of what your men think about? I'm not going to engage in this if my men are on the warfare and they're on the battle lines and their lives are on the line. I'm not going to give myself to pleasure. But David, somewhere along the lines, had given into complacency and began to believe that this world was his home. And it led to the worst decisions that David ever made in his life. Let that one sink right here. We're welcomed in, just as we are, not to stay there. And we're strangers and pilgrims in this world. We're strangers and pilgrims in this world. Amen? Point three, we could see from these accounts, they were to grow even in the midst of hardship and promise. They were to grow in the midst of both hardship and promise. David had been anointed the king of Israel. But he was not to wait by idly until the promise came to pass. You catch that? Point three, they were to grow even in the midst of promise and hardship. No matter what came their way, God wanted them to continue to strategize, continue to cooperate, continue to grow, continue to learn, to continue to be disciples. Just because the promise laid before them, it did not take away the responsibilities of the present. Amen? Listen, David had already been anointed the king. He could go find a cave somewhere, shut the door, and say, see you later, bring me out when the promise comes to pass. I'm just going to go into my prayer closet. I'm not going to do anything, just going to pray. In no way do you take that to mean that I don't believe in the power of prayer. But if our prayer does not lead us to do something, I wonder how effective our praying is or how effective our listening is in those prayers. Because I believe that God is a God who wants his people to act. Can I get an amen to that? God wants his people to act. And it's in prayer that we actually have the right understanding of how we're to act. We don't know how to act otherwise, but we are to act. Promise and persecution cannot keep us from growth. David's not to sit there idly waiting around. Matthew Henry, the famous writer who would expound upon the scriptures in his concordance, he writes, the promise of the kingdom implied a promise of preservation to it. And yet David used proper means for his own safety. Otherwise, he would have tempted God. See, David was still engaged in making sure that he stayed alive, even though the promise was, I'm going to make you king. And it seems like even in that promise that, yeah, I'm going to be king. Who could stand before me? Jesus said not to tempt, put God to the test. Some people say, well, God's called me to this, and therefore, you know, I could do this, this, and the other thing. Listen, when you are called to be a Christian and you willingly give yourself over to sin, you're putting God to the test. aren't you? When you willingly do it. It's not to take away the fact of our human condition, but if we're not coming to God with the understanding that, God, you're desiring me for to go and grow, to go and to grow, to go and to grow. And it says of David that he went about going and growing, and God caused him to be exalted. That we are engaged in the process of making sure that our life's protected, that we're doing everything within our means, proper means. Some people say, you know, God has a plan on my life so I can eat whatever I want, do whatever I want, and everything. I say, you're putting God to the test. You should be asking God, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to grow? What is it, God, that's pleasing to you? See, David's men, it wasn't about they came to David and, yeah, David's going to become the king so they can stay in their distress and their debt and their discontentedness. They could stay there because ultimately the promise is going to come to pass. No, God was asking them in the process of waiting to grow in waiting. Waiting was an active thing. In the process of waiting for the kingdom to be established, David was now training these men because he became their captain. And as their captain, he was beginning to train them how to use military weapons, how to exercise discernment, how to work together for the common good, how to build a structured army so that they could advance against the cities around them, preparing in the little things. Because if you're faithful in the little things, what will God do? He'll make you rule over much. But if you're not faithful in what's little, what's God going to be able to do with you? Amen? He's calling us to be faithful. 2 Peter chapter 1. Reading from verse 5, you'll see that we're to give all diligence, adding to our faith, and there's a whole list of things. Saying that if we continue to engage in the things of growth and growth and growth, growing in the things of God, that we would provide for ourselves an opportunity that we wouldn't stumble and fall. Verse 10 is a verse, it's an interesting verse. He says, wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and your election sure. Give diligence to make your call and your election sure. Hey, Don, does that make a lot of sense? Give diligence to make your call and your election sure. What is a call and what is an election? It's what God has declared to be the truth. It's what God has declared to be the reality of your life. And here, Peter says, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, you do your diligence to make sure that you make it sure. See, even though you've been anointed King David, you got to continue to do the things that show that you're faithful. We need to be diligent and faithful, even in the midst of promise, and also hardship. Because the promise cannot keep us in apathy, and nor can hardship keep us in complacency. We need to grow no matter what state we find ourselves in. Amen? Amen? Be careful. Give diligence to make your call and your election sure. And finally, I read out of Luke chapter 19, verses 11 through 14, Jesus giving a parable. And now as they heard these things, he spoke another parable because he was near Jerusalem and because they thought the kingdom of God would appear immediately. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and return. So he called 10 of his servants, delivered to them 10 minas, which were a pound, so 10 pounds, and he said to them, which is money. King James says what? Occupy till I come. The New King James says, do business till I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we will not have this man reign over us. I can't help but see the correlation between what was going on with David and his mighty men. The man's been anointed the king. He's going off basically into a far country to make sure that everything was put in the pieces together because there was opposition and hostility in his homeland. God was preparing him in adversity. But he was saying, do business till I come, occupy till I come. Make sure you're making progress in the midst of circumstances that seem like they're bad. Every decision that we make on an everyday basis is preparing for us opportunity to enter into our future that God's called us into. Your life is filled with promise, but that does not take away responsibility from us. We are joint heirs with Christ. We are co-laborers together with Christ. We're laboring together with Christ. We're laboring, as Peter said, to make our call and our election sure. See, first, we're welcomed in, right as we are. But God's going to do a work in our life, and he's going to make something out of you. He's going to make a machine out of you that you would never believe to be true. He's going to make you a match for no one to stand before you, whether they're giants or obstacles or armies that are vast. God is making for you a person who can stand before all adversity. He's making for you a man of war. As David said, the Lord trains my hands for war. See, the war we're dealing with now is not a natural one. Paul said to the Corinthians, the weapons of our warfare are not natural. They're not carnal, but they're mighty through God. They're mighty weapons over the mindsets that have enveloped people's lives, the logic that people operate by, that God's allowing us to be able to break down the logic which is false, an understanding or thinking that God is so far away or God doesn't exist at all. My life is my own. I just got to do the best that I can. You know, as long as I'm a good person, everything is fine. Our battle is much greater than just a battle between humankind. Ephesians chapter 6, it says, we don't fight against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and rules, spiritual wickedness in high places. It's time for God's church to engage and realize something. You're a soldier. Whether you like it or not, you've been called into a battle. It's a battle of all ages. It's a battle for the souls of men. You got to know this, that you're welcomed in right where you're at. God's going to make something out of you that you would never believe. God's got a plan that's way better than your own. Surrender your own agenda. Lay it down and let God take over and find out what God will do, because he wins. Amen. You got to remember this principle as you're engaging in God's warfare is this, that you are strangers and pilgrims. This world's not your home. You're in warfare. Don't engage in civilian activity. It will be to your detriment. It will destroy you from the inside out. It will lead you to make decisions that you will regret the remainder of your life. It happened with David. David lived his whole life in regret over those decisions that he made. He couldn't get those back. He couldn't get Uriah back. He couldn't take away the fact that he lost the child because of his adultery. He couldn't take away the fact that he had taken a census because he had taken the king's crown from another king and put it upon his own head and begin to embrace all the principles of that king and say, well, we need to know how big our kingdom is, and begin to take a census, begin to have an enlarged heart. His heart began to grow proud. He couldn't take back the fact that pestilence and plague went through the camp for 3 days and 70,000 people lost their lives. He couldn't take that back. That was his fault. It was his bad. Why? Because he had engaged the fact that he could live in pleasure while his men were in war. The Bible says that we need to remember those who are suffering persecution all over the world as if we were suffering together with them. Do you remember that aspect of what Jesus said? If there's other in warfare that is very heavily engaged, we also are to be engaged in warfare. We are not to give ourselves over to pleasure life. Why? Because we're attaining for ourselves a crown that is sure and that's forever. Because our home's not here, our home is eternity. Our home is heaven, and heaven is forever. If we would measure our life based upon the brevity of all things, man, our days on this planet are so small, eternity is forever. You're not laying something down that you're not gonna receive rich reward for. Amen? With your head bowed this morning, remember, we're welcomed. We're strangers and pilgrims, but we're also called to grow in the midst of promise and hardship. We're called to grow, even when God said he's going to do something for your life, which in your mind says, well, he's going to keep me alive long enough to see it. You are still called to engage in all the things of obedience. You are called to make your calling and election sure. So we pray this morning, Father, would you receive me in? You said there'll be volunteers in the day of your power. No one's going to be forced in. You can't force anyone into God's kingdom. God's kingdom is to those who willingly enlist. I tell you this morning, there's an enlisting taking place. I ask if you would sign on the dotted line, say, Lord, I sign my rights away to you to be a part, to have the privilege of being in your forces. Your forces, God, your training. You're training a mighty army that are no match. Forget man, you're no match for the powers of darkness. That even demons submit to us, Lord, in your name. Come on, there's a place where God's people begin to engage in the realities of this warfare over men's souls and realize that I got mighty weapons in prayer to pull down strongholds that people don't think they want God, but they want God, and they're going to want God because I'm going to pray for them and realize that power in prayer that is there because we are warriors in God's army. And when you're engaged in God's army and when you're wearing his uniform, you walk as a man under authority, and all the authority of God's kingdom is right there. When you say, in the name of Jesus, all of heaven moves because you're enlisted in his forces, volunteers in the day of his power. Praise God for that. Amen. So this morning, would you be willing to sign your name on that dotted line saying, God, I surrender all rights to myself, God, and I'm enlisting in your army today, God. I want to be welcomed in, Lord God, just as I am. I might not have my act together right now, God, but I'm willing to enter into your boot camp. I'm willing to allow you to be the way shaping not only my behavior, but the way I think, God, to shape every aspect of my life, God, that I would learn to be a winner, no longer a loser. Learn to be one, God, that's the head, no longer the tail. Learn to be one, God, that's prosperous and no longer a beggar. God, I'm signing up, God, to be taught by the best of the best. I'm signing up to be taught by the commander in chief of all the armies of heaven. It says that David's men begin to grow into a mighty army like the host of heaven. And so even David's mighty army began to become a picture of the fact that God is a God of angel armies. God is a God of warfare. Our God is a warrior. The Lord of hosts is his name. Just sign up on the list today. Say, God, here I am. Here I am. Just you and God right now. And once you've done your business with God, you're dismissed. Say, God, I'm going to move into your plan. I know I'm welcomed. Help me to rely on you completely. Help me to diminish the grapple hold that this world has on me and to count myself a pilgrim and stranger. And God, take me out of complacency and apathy and thinking I don't have to do anything, God. And let me be a disciplined individual, a disciple of Jesus Christ, learning your ways, taking your yoke upon me and learning of you. In Jesus' name, let that be our prayer. When the Lord's done with you, you're welcome to leave. If you want special prayer, I'll be glad to pray with you this morning. Don't forget, tonight, 6 p.m., I encourage you to be here. I believe you're going to hear of a warrior out on the front lines of the enemy's battleground doing great work for him. Amen.